for whom you are making education investment and who pays for it. Now when the government make investment in education, say investment in primary education or secondary or the higher education, and they make expenditure, then definitely the target group will be benefited. So first you have to find out the beneficiaries and the person who is contributing towards the fund of the government. So for example, if we make some special package for SCST students, government is making some special package for SCST students or economically poor students, instead of caste, state is on the basis of the economic status, then those target group will be benefited. If free education is given, maintenance expenditure is given, free books is given, then this particular group, economically backward classes, will be benefited. Now, will it lead to equitable distribution in society? Definitely the target group is economically poor. But then who is paying for this education? Is it by the rich people or by the poor people? If it is paid by the poor people, if the expenditure is borne by the poor people, then it will not bring about much equitable distribution. But if the expenditure is borne by the rich people, then there will be transfer of income from rich to poor, so society will have equitable distribution. Suppose, for example, the government makes expenditures on higher education. In higher education, you will find that relatively richer section of people come to higher education. Now, if the expenditure is made for higher education, basically, say 50 to 60% of the richer population will benefit. Then who bears it? Who is paying taxes to the government? Is it rich people or poor people? If the poor people pay for the education of rich people, then it will adversely affect the equitable distribution. So here two things. Now it depends on who gets the benefit and then who pays. These are the two basic questions based on which you can judge whether the educational development leads to equitable distribution of income or not. Now, for example, if we make an investment in primary education in Assam, let us say primary education. Suppose the Assam government has decided to make an investment of say 1000 crores on primary education, rupees 1000 crores. Then who will benefit? Do you send your children to government primary school? Particularly in the urban areas, they don't send it. Particularly the comfortably, I don't say rich people, comfortably say better off people send their children to English medium school. Because of many reasons, good discipline, there may not be good education, but discipline is there. But let us say that good education, good discipline. Now, we send our children to the private schools. And who send the children to the government schools? Relatively poor people. Relatively poor people, particularly people living in the rural areas, people living in the semi-urban areas, they send their children to the primary schools, government primary school. And when the government makes expenditure of 1000 crores, and those children will be benefited, not the children going to the private school. So the target group we know that it is economically poor people. So economically poor people will be benefited if the government makes an investment of 1000 crores for primary education. And suppose that this money government gets through, of course state government cannot impose income tax. Let us say that government impose some taxes which vitally affect the rich people. Let us say wealth tax. So Assam government has increased the wealth tax, and out of the wealth tax 1000 additional crores of rupees has been collected, and this money is spent for the poor people. So who is paying the wealth tax? Those who are basically rich, they have big amount of wealth, so they have to pay wealth tax. So when it happens, when wealth tax is imposed and is spent for the economically backward people, economically poor people, then there is a transfer of fund. There is a transfer from
There is a transfer of fund from rich to poor.
So it will lead to equitable distribution in society.
The other way around, let us assume that the government spend, say, 1,000 crores in higher education. So when the government pays 1,000 crores in higher education, in higher education scenario, what you find that for rich and poor people are benefited. And suppose the government collect this additional fund, 1,000 crores, out of sales tax. So out of 1,000 crores of rupees, relatively rich people, relatively better off people, as well as poor people will also be benefited, because higher education system for rich and poor are there. But these days, I'm not talking about 40 years back, these days, when we were students, mostly students were poor. But these days, most of these students undertaking higher education, they're relatively better off. I don't say rich, but they're better off. Now, when 1,000 crores is spent on higher education for college and universities in Assam, and government imposes additional sales tax. Now, who is paying sales tax? Everybody is paying. Whatever the sales tax paid by, say, for example, a very rich Marwari in fancy bazaar, the same sales tax is paid by you and me. There is no discrimination. They are not paying higher sales tax. Even a beggar is paying the same sales tax. Even a daily laborer is paying the same sales tax. So the sales tax is imposed, an additional 1,000 crore is collected. Now, whether there is a transfer of fund from rich to poor or poor to rich?
Poor to rich.
Poor to rich. So it will lead to just the opposite scenario. It will lead to transfer of funds from poor to rich. So equitable distribution will not take place. So education is such an instrument. It can lead to equitable distribution in society, or also it may lead to the opposite situation. It may lead to inequitable distribution in society. So what I mean to say that education can be taken as an instrument to make equitable distribution in society by transferring fund from poor to rich to poor, by making educational expenditure for benefiting the poor people and collected the fund from the rich people, either in form of taxes or in form of other duties. Again, education can also be used as an instrument for equitable distribution. Suppose if the government gives for special scholarship, just like the government, state government gives scholarship to the meritorious students also, SC, ST, OBC, then economically backward also, then it will lead to equitable distribution. Free education or subsidized education to the economically poorer people, then it will lead to, again, the equitable distribution of income and society. Now let me come to the fourth point, educational planning and manpower planning. Now, as I told you at the very beginning, one of the basic problems in our country is the problem of educated unemployment. There are many reasons for this. I will not spell out all the reasons. One is that the curriculum may not be up to the expectation of the industries. It is not reflected in either of the society, neither of the industries. And secondly that the population is increasing at a such rate that that job created by the industry and agriculture is not enough to absorb the increasing population. And thirdly, the most important is that there is no planning. There is no planning in educational development as well as manpower development. So the plan, because of the lack of planning, we have a gap between demand and supply. Demand and supply of manpower. And when the gap is increasing, when the supply is more, demand is less, unemployment is increasing. You cannot make unemployment zero. It is very difficult to make it. Even the advanced countries also, they have some percentage of unemployed persons. But that can be reduced, the gap can be reduced. Gap between demand and supply can be reduced by making appropriate and adequate planning. And when you talk about the planning, there are two types of planning. One is the manpower planning, the other is the educational planning, and the other is the manpower planning. So actually it is the two sides of the same coin, just like that. Because without manpower planning, you cannot have educational planning. Educational planning is adjusted to the manpower planning. So I'll tell you how educational planning is adjusted to manpower planning, which is lacking in our country. Not to speak of Assam, in the whole country you don't have well-planned manpower planning and educational planning. Suppose, for example, take a simple example here. Let us take the case of our state. Suppose there is a
hydrel project, state government electricity board for hydrel project, new hydrel project, which requires 500 civil engineers, 400 electrical engineers, say 1000 junior engineers, say 2000, like that, various type of technical persons we need for construction of the hydrel project for generation of electricity. It is a project for say 5 years. Now first we have to see the, whether this manpower will be available in our state. And the availability of manpower will depend on availability of educational institutions. Say we have few technical institutions, Jorhat Engineering College, then Guwahati Engineering College, then NIT, Silchar, and say three private engineering colleges. So these are institutions available locally where you can produce the engineers and technical persons. And also we have some polytechnics and ITH. Now these are polytechnics and ITHs are giving junior engineers and technical assistants. Now we have to first see whether these persons are available or not. And if they are not available, then what we can do, that we can ask the engineering colleges to increase the number of seats. So in the next 2-3 years, we need this number of civil engineers, electrical engineers, some mechanical engineers, let us say 200 mechanical engineers, say another 100 electronic engineers. Like that, various categories of engineers we need. And these will be supplied by the engineering colleges. Not to speak of IITs, engineering colleges will have to supply. And so what the government can do, that policymakers can do, we can ask the existing engineering colleges, both government and private, to increase the number of seats. And engineering colleges may not be able to increase the number of seats. They may say that we can increase just 10%. 10% seat means they can increase the 20 seats in this, say, 40 seats here, the 100 seats here, or say 80 seats here, like that. Say it is again say 200 seats, or maybe. So these are the number of additional seats they can provide. So we cannot get then 100, 200, 500, 400, 1000, 2000. So the project will be affected. So that proposed hydrel project cannot be implemented because of lack of technical persons. So we'll have to import people from outside. That is also not sensible. There will be UN cry that outsiders are invited to work in Assam. But the best thing is to that, you have to make a proper planning that we want to utilize our local as an engineer in this power project. And so the existing engineering colleges, technical institutes can only marginally increase 10% seats. So when they cannot increase the whole amount of the number of required persons, then what we can do that? We can go for additional engineering colleges. We can go for additional engineering college because we need more engineers. And this process, it is not only for 5 years. When you go for one engineering college, you think for next 100 years. So there will be some new project will come after 2-3 years. And there will be continuous demand for engineers from the engineering college. So the decision government can take or private policymakers can take, that will go for additional engineering college. That is called educational plan. They make plan in such a way that the required number of engineers, required number of junior engineers, required number of technical assistants will be produced by the new educational institutions. You have to make the planning like that. So first you have to make the demand for manpower. You have to make estimate. And then supply of manpower. These two sides you have to find out. What is the demand for manpower, demand for various types of engineers? This is only in case of a particular project. But if you take the whole state, your demand for manpower will be different. Engineers, doctors, agriculturists, then commerce graduates. So many various types of qualified, technically, academically qualified persons you need to have for the whole economy of the state. But this is an example I have taken just for a particular project of hydrel power project. Now, accordingly, you have to find out what is the demand for manpower, various types of manpower, electrical engineer, electronic engineer, mechanical engineer, civil engineers, junior engineers. These are the demand we have to find out. And then accordingly you have to find out what is the supply coming up from the existing education institution. If the existing education institution cannot provide the additional requirement, then you have to go for additional colleges, engineering colleges. That is what is called the educational planning. So first you have to find out the manpower planning. So you have to make the planning in such a way that you have some estimation of the requirement of manpower, and accordingly the requirement of manpower is adjusted with the expansion of educational institutions. when these two will be done parallelly, then only unemployment level will come. And this is totally lacking in our country, totally lacking in this part of the country. And so we have the basic problem of unemployment. Now the question is that how to find out the supply of manpower. The supply of manpower is very easy to find out. You can take the various engineering colleges through the particular project, and if you take the state as a whole, what is the demand for manpower in 2011-2010? In that case, when you talk about a demand for manpower in 2010 in a particular state, at a particular point of time, then you have to find out this fact, that how many matriculates and how many higher secondary holders. In higher secondary holders, again, you have to find out science, arts, commerce, then degree, TGC, science, then management, all those degrees. Then you can find with PG, various subjects, science and commerce. And some of them are already absorbed after passing either matriculation or higher secondary or BA or MA, whatever it is. So some of them are already absorbed and some of them are still unemployed. So from these institutions, so SEBA or Higher Secondary Council or Guwahati Dibrugarh University or Assam University, we know this engineering college, medical graduates, etc. So we have the figures that these are available manpower at a particular point of today in 2010. Available manpower of the various categories we know. And some of them passed this year, some of them passed last year, some of them passed in 2001, they are still unemployed. So they are available with us. But how do you know what will be the demand for manpower? Just like if you have a project like this, a Hydel project, you can know that what is the demand for manpower, particularly in technical jobs. So if you take the whole state as a whole, how do you find out what is the demand for commerce graduate, demand for arts graduate, demand for science graduate, again in science graduate, demand for chemistry, demand for computer science, demand for geological science, in postgraduate subject also demand for sociology, computer science, demand for management. How do you find out? It is very difficult to find out the demand. And the demand depends on expected or proposed economic activity of the state, activity of the economy. The whole thing will depend on the proposed economic activity. Say for example, just like the state government has taken a central project or say taken a scheme that there will be a hospital, small primary hospital in every block. So there are 129 blocks in Assam, and in all 129 blocks there will be one small hospital. Suppose this is a policy taken by the state government. Then for each hospital there will be say 10 doctors, 20 nurses, 20 technical assistants, and so another 20 third grade and fourth grade, plus another say 5 accounts assistant or 3 accounts assistant. Now these are the jobs required for each small hospital in each block. What is the demand for manpower? How many doctors you need? So 129 blocks into 10, 1290 doctors you need. Then nurses you need almost 2500 nurses. Similarly, technical assistant 2500. Then similarly, third grade, fourth grade employee also so many. Of course, third grade, fourth grade, there are lot of unemployed, but you don't have any problem. But the problem will be regarding doctor and nurses, you don't have it. So what you have to do that? If this is your demand. So the scheme is that there will be a hospital in each block, and each hospital requires this number of manpower. Doctor, nurses, target program employee, technical assistant, account assistant, etc. Now these will be available from the educational system. But if the existing medical colleges cannot provide so many doctors, because most of the doctors are employed, you don't have unemployed doctors. Maybe hardly, say, 1% unemployed doctors may be there. 99% are absorbed. Now, if we need to implement this particular scheme, hospital in East Block, then either you can ask the medical colleges to increase the number of seats. They may increase the seat from 200, so they can go to 220, not more than that. Then the only alternative is that the government will go for the establishment of new medical colleges. That is logically there. But I do not know, the government is also having new medical colleges, whether they are applying their mind about the demand or not, I do not know. Barpeta, Jura, Kukrajar, maybe some political decision they are taking it without considering the need. There may be need, but they are not considering it. There may not be any need, that also they are not considering. So this is not scientifically done. First, we should find out what is the demand, what is the need for medical colleges. If there is a need, go for. Suppose there is no need for medical college, there is a need for primary school. Instead of spending 300 crores for two medical colleges, you spend the 300 crores in primary school. So we have to see the demand, where is the need? Or it may be required to have a science college instead of a medical college. Or instead of a science college, you go for engineering college. We have to see the demand for manpower. Depending on the demand, you go for expansion of education. But this is not taking place. So similarly, suppose if the government takes a decision, say for example, say each village will have a primary school. Now at the moment, all the villages do not have primary school. Each village has a primary school, means there will be about 50,000 primary schools. And for 50,000 primary school, you just imagine that each primary school, suppose have 5 teachers. 50,000 means 2,50,000 new teachers supposed to be here. So whether these will be available or not. Trained teachers will be available or not. If the trained teachers are not available, then you go for some educational program on teachers training. Without training, you cannot have good education. So you go for, instead of going for medical college, instead of going for one engineering college or for some arts college, go for some research training college. That is the planning, that is the educational planning. Now, this is the segmentation of the whole economy. Whether you have a scheme about the a primary school in a village or a medical college in a, or say in a hospital in a block, these are some segmentation of the scheme. When you take the whole economy as a whole, you have so many schemes are there. Health related scheme, education related scheme, then school related scheme, various type of schemes are there. In that case, how to find out the manpower requirement. So there is a technique developed by one great economist. That technique is known as input-output technique. The technique is known as, so it was developed by Wall Street Leon Tis. He is still alive, he is about 95 years old. So he was awarded a Nobel Prize in Economics. Nobel Prize in Economics in 86. So he developed a model called input-output model. And with the help of this model, we can find out the manpower requirement at a future date. Say for example, we know the manpower requirement in 2010 or 2009. But what will be the manpower requirement in 2020, that we do not know. What will be the requirement in 2020, it is a far away to go. Next 10 years or next 5 years or even 2015, we do not know. So you have to find out the technique on the basis of which you can find out what will be the manpower requirement at a future date. So there is one technique called that projection method you can follow. So the manpower requirement in the last 10 years, and on the basis of that you can make projection by using some statistical techniques or by using the computer. You can make a projection for next 5 years or 10 years, what will be the manpower requirement, various type of manpower. Arts graduate, science graduate, engineering graduate, medical graduate, matriculate, higher secondary, arts, science, commerce, so various types of categories of manpower you can make projection based on the requirement in the last 5-10 years. That you can do it with a statistical method by regression method. But it is not very dependable. In a dynamic society, every day everything is changing. But this method, developed by Leon Tip, it is more scientific and also more accurate of projection of manpower demand. So actually basically the model was developed by Leontief to find out the production output of various industries at a future date. What will be the production of agriculture in 2010 or 2015 or 2020? What will be the production of small scale industries, say handicrafts, handloom, production of oil, production of tea, production of iron and steel, but are various categories of goods and services. So what will be the demand for say banking service in 2020? So these you cannot find out isolatedly. So these you will have to find out in a composite manner. So that composite manner, that Lealty model help us in finding out the output of production and service, production as well as service. Production means physical goods and service means facilities provided by the institution, like banking service, educational service, and public administration. These are services. Now in this particular model, once you find out the output or services of various categories of activities, then you can easily find out what will be manpower requirement. Say for example, If you know in 2010, 2020, the agricultural production will be, say, for example, in Assam, this say 20 lakh ton of rice, 20 lakh ton of rice. Then you can find out what will be the manpower required for 1 lakh ton of rice. To produce 1 lakh ton of rice with the modern technology, manpower will be less. If you produce with traditional method with, say, plow and bullock, then you need more people. So it depends on the technology also. So there you can find out, say, if for 1 lakh ton of rice, you need so many people. So accordingly, 20 lakh ton of rice, you can find out what will be the manpower requirement. Once you know the output, similarly, if you know that tea production will be in 2020, will be double than today, then manpower will also be double. Production of oil will be, say, suppose that it will increase by 50% or 100%, then employment will also increase by 100%. So accordingly, once you know the output, then you can find out the manpower requirement. So this model, when he developed, he was using a lot of mathematics. The logic behind this particular model is that whatever output you produce, any output, it is either used for self-consumption. So for example, you produce agriculture. Paddy you are producing. Paddy is used for self-consumption as uses seed. A part of the paddy is used as seed. 10%, let us say, that whatever the output you produce, 10% is used as seed. Then suppose whatever the output you produce, suppose 80% is used as rice meal, as raw material. 80% of paddy is used as raw material in rice meal. And suppose another 10% is used for animal husbandry sector, as a food for the cows and buffaloes. So the total production of paddy, we see that 10% is used as seed, 80% for rice meal, for the human consumption, and another 10% for animal husbandry sector. That we know. Similarly, when paddy is converted to rice, once paddy is converted to rice, the rice is used in various industries. Rice is used in where? Say, 10% is used in hotel and restaurant. Then 70% used as basic food by the families. Another 10% is used, let us say, this is a hypothetical. Let us say these are used as raw material in food processing industry. Raw material in food processing industry. Say another, say, now these are the output distributed for various activities. For the home consumption, hotel, food processing industry and the production of liquor. Now again, when you use rice in the food processing industry, I'm just showing the link. The first that you are producing paddy, it is a part of agriculture. Paddy part, 10 part, this is an easier seed. This is used as the rice mill and this is as animal husbandry. The rice mill product also been used in various parts. And then when you use the food processing industry to produce certain amount of output in food processing industry, what are the other inputs you need? You need machinery, you need electricity, then you need diesel also to drive the machine if there is no electricity available. You need chemical. You need preservative. These are the various type of things you need. So, for even for food processing industry, chemical you need, machinery you need, electricity, petroleum product. So then again, when you need more petroleum product for food processing industry, at least certain additional liter of petrol or petroleum product must be produced in refinery. Refinery needs more inputs. What the refinery needs? Refinery needs crude oil. Electricity generation need. If you need additional electricity, means you need more diesel. You need hydel power. Petroleum needs crude oil, then chemical, then machinery. Now see, ultimately everything is linked with paddy. So in this way, the whole economy is interrelated. When you produce this particular cloth, it is related to agriculture, because textile you need. It is related to petroleum. Synthetic fiber is coming from petroleum. Then it is related to machinery. You need machinery to produce it. So many chemical you need. Dyeing you need. So many things you need to produce a particular product. So all the sectors of the economy are interrelated. So if you want to produce more agricultural product, or if you want to produce more food processing product, then definitely you will have more demand for other products. Say when you want to produce more paddy, then what are the inputs you need? Again, this is the forward linkage. This is a linkage between these various sectors. Forward, what you need after the production. But before production of paddy, what do you need? You need fertilizer, you need electricity, you need diesel, you need power tiller, you need pump set. These are electrical goods. Then you need irrigation unit. So these are the impulse unit. You need insecticides. So these will be coming from different industries. Fertilizer will come from the fertilizer industry. The fertilizer industry also needs some other inputs. Say for example, number of fertilizer needs gas. And some other fertilizer factory needs some other chemicals. So these way the whole economy is interrelated. So on the basis of the interrelationship, Leontief developed this input-output model. So this input-output model, I just tell you that whatever be the, suppose these are the outputs of the economy. Output X1, X2, X3. Suppose this is agriculture, this is industry, this is petroleum, this is electricity, this is iron and steel. Suppose this is public administration, banking service, etc. These are the various sectors of the economy. And the output of this sector, this depends on output of all sectors. So agriculture production depends on fertilizer, electricity, diesel, banking service, you know, take loan from the bank, and public administration. When you use the government machinery. Similarly, the second sector, suppose this is animal husbandry. Animal husbandry depends on agriculture. It depends on animal husbandry itself. It depends on, say, fertilizer like that. It depends on all these sectors. Similarly, action also depends on X1, X2, etc. So this is the logic. The output of any industry, any sector of the economy depends on all other sectors of the economy. Based on this logic, Leontief found that, I'm just giving it a matrix form. This is a matrix form that we write it as a vector. It is denoted by capital X. It is a vector. It is a column of output, x1, x2, x3, xn. In mathematics, we call it a vector. So this is a vector, column vector of output. And similarly, this is called a identity matrix. I will not explain it. And this is also called input-output coefficient matrix. So this is the main thing. The interrelationship is shown by this capital A. This is called a input-output coefficient matrix. Size is n into n. Suppose economy has the 20 sectors at 20 into 20. So based on this, Leontief adopted the technique of finding out the sectoral output of all the sectors of economy at a future date. Our interest is to find out what will be the output at the future date in 2015 or 2020. Once you know the output that the economy should produce, then you can accordingly find out the manpower requirement. For 1 rupee production of paddy, how much manpower you need? For 1 rupee production of banking service, how much manpower you need? That you can find out. So based on that, we can find out the manpower requirement in banking sector, what will be the different types of manpower. In agriculture, what are the different types of manpower we need? How many agricultural graduates we need? How many agricultural technicians we need? How many unskilled labor we need? And how many skilled labor we need? This can be found out. How many tractor we need? How much of other inputs we need? We can easily find out. And based on that, then when you find out that this will be the manpower requirement at the future date, then you see what is the existing educational institutions provide. Whether the existing educational institutions, Assam Agriculture University, then Kishi Bigyan Kendras, then engineering colleges, then ITIs, then polytechnic, whether they will be able to provide the required manpower. If they cannot provide the manpower, then accordingly you expand education towards that direction. If you need more agricultural scientists, go for another agricultural college. If you need more engineers, go for another engineering college. If you need more commerce graduates, go for another two commerce colleges. So this is how we should make the planning. This is called the educational plan. So educational planning initially it depends basically on manpower requirement, manpower planning. So manpower planning will give you the what will be the manpower requirement. Once you know the requirement, then accordingly make the planning for production of manpower. So go for additional colleges or schools or institutions. Anyway, the other part, last one, financial education. So far as this financing is concerned, there is a very important component of economics education. Without financing, you cannot have education development. Now, so far the financing is concerned, two, three questions comes to our mind. Whether the financing of education is adequate? Is it adequate or not? Is it adequate? First thing is that. Or is it equitable? Now, whether it is adequate or not, there are two views. One view is a very traditional view. Till 1970, the conventional view is that a country or a state spends 20% of its budget on education. 20% of the budget on education, 20% of budget. Then it was known as adequate, or it was considered to be adequate. Or if 8% of the 8% of state income or GDP, if 8% of state income or GDP is spent on education, that is also considered to be adequate. Either 20% of the total budget, annual budget, or 8% of the state income or GDP, then it is considered to be adequate. But the problem is that when you talk about the adequacy in terms of expenditure, actually it may not lead to educational development, because the money may not be properly utilized. A major part of the money may be misused. And that is why World Bank in the late 70s has indicated certain criteria for deciding whether the expenditure on education is adequate or not. So the criteria are like this. Number one, what is student teacher ratio? Then what is male female ratio? Then female enrollment, dropout rate. These are some of the criteria on the basis of which you can decide whether the educational expenditure is adequate or not. Suppose the student teacher ratio is very high, number of teachers is low, student is very high, then the educational expenditure is not adequate. Similarly, suppose the male female ratio is also very high. Female is less, enrollment of female is less, male is very high. That means education is not adequately provided, particularly female children or female persons. Then that is also not adequate. If the female enrollment is also low, that is also not adequate, considered to be adequate. And if the dropout rate is high, it is also considered that the expenditure on education is not adequate. So these are some of the criteria developed by the World Bank. Based on the criteria, we can judge whether the educational expenditure is adequate or need to be more. Now, if you consider these criteria, particularly in the state of Assam, you will find that in the primary school, some of the schools have large number of teachers and some of the schools have only one or two teachers. So, from that point of view, some schools do not have the adequate amount of investment in education. There are five classes, only two teachers. How can you expect good education, better education in a school where two teachers are teaching five classes? And then again, you have to see that infrastructure,
education infrastructure.
So whether you have adequate classroom or not, whether there is sitting at accommodation or not. So if you go to the rural area, you will find that in the same classroom, in the same room, two classes are taking place. One this side, looking this side, another looking this side. Can you expect good education? One teacher is sitting that side without any wall, other teacher is sitting this side. So this is, education is not adequate because you don't have infrastructure. I am not talking about computer and other things, but at least the classroom and desks and benches should be available. And in some areas you will find that, but in rural areas, the student going to school carrying two things, one bag in hand and another got in his hand, a mat. So this is inadequate. So at least you should provide some infrastructure. So these are some of the criteria on the basis of which World Bank now says that this is that whether you spend 20% or 8%, we are not concerned. Whether you provide these facilities or not, whether the adequate number of teachers or not, whether the male-female ratio is adequate or not, whether the dropout rate is high or low. If dropout rate is very high, then educational expenditure is not adequate. You have to make more expenditure, you have to give more training, you have to give more teacher. Then if the infrastructure is not adequate, then you have to make more expenditure. So these are some of the criteria suggested by the World Bank in the post-1970s. Earlier, the conventional system, when you talk about a conventional system, 20% expenditure is adequate. But who knows whether 20% is spent on education or 5% is spent? Nobody knows. 15% or only 5% is spent, and remaining 15% may be misused by the officials and the administrators. That is why World Bank is very firm that instead of spending the amount of money, you tell us what is the physical criteria, whether the student teacher ratio is high, male female ratio is there, dropout rate is high or low, infrastructure is available or not. These are the criteria on the basis of which you can decide whether educational expenditure is adequate or not. Now, there is a question that whether educational expenditure can increase efficiency in the educational system. The question is yes. So actually that is a system adopted in UK and USA about 20 years back. What happens that you might be knowing that in some of the schools, the result is out. Higher secondary result is out, matriculation result. You might get the report tomorrow in the newspaper that about 20 schools do not have any percentage of students. Percentage pass is zero. Last year also about 22 schools did not have any student passing out of matriculation. Now why it is so? The reason is that they will claim that the students are not up to the expectation. But what about the teachers? The teachers are not very serious. They are not taking classes regularly. They are not giving the proper training to the students. That is why the percentage of pass is zero. Sometimes percentage of pass is 5%. Now in that case, the question is whether those schools should continue or just close down. The same, this is a human psychology. When you are assured that you will get the salary from the government in the primary, in the high school or primary school, nobody takes care of it. But if you just make it related to efficiency, then everybody will take care of it. Now the same thing happened in UK, that after all this is a human factor, that when the job is assured, people become more lethargic to the job. So in UK also, the same thing happened, that some of the schools, their results were very poor in A level, O level. And some of the schools are good, because the teachers are serious, principal is, atmosphere is taking care of it, then the results are very good. And some schools are very poor in results. So what the UK government did, they give the funding to the schools through the county, through the state government, county government. Now what they did, that instead of giving fund to the schools, high schools, they gave the fund to the students. So what they say, that they call it voucher. They call it voucher system. So when the fund is given to the school, they were assured of the fund, that we get the fund, we'll get the salary. Instead of giving fund to the school, they give fund to the student. That they give a voucher, that's like a check to each of the student. And giving the option that you can take admission anywhere in UK. Then what the student will do? They'll go to the best school. They will not go to the school where percentage of pass is low. They are going to the very good school and best schools. And there's a great rush of students in the good schools. And nobody is coming to the bad schools. So when the students are not coming to the relatively bad school, or the lesser number is coming, then they will get less fee. Everything is coming through the student now. When you take a, say for example, there are three schools, say ABC. There are suppose three schools, ABC. So this is very good, this is good, bad. So when you give the voucher to the student, that this is the guarantee of the money, you go to any school, and by showing this particular voucher, you will get admission. Fee, the total fee will be paid by the government. Now suppose the very good school, say here, out of 200 students, say 150 comes here, and 40 comes here, and 10 comes here. Hypothetically, say 200 students were given the voucher, just like a check. 150 comes to school, 40 here and 10 here. Then 150 students they will get, then they will get lot of money. And this school could be only 10 students. The money is not even enough for paying for salary for 1 month. So those school teachers will get less salary. And here these school teachers will get good salary. And they will continue to get low salary next year also if they do not improve the quality. Then what happens, that there is a competition among these three schools, ABC. Then the school where the results were bad last year, they will try to improve it. When the result improves, more students will come. That is the system. The same amount of money. See, UK government did not increase the amount of money. Earlier they directly give to the schools, same amount of money now they are giving to the students. Ultimately, competition among these schools improved the quality of education. 78%. It has reduced.
I think, sir, the UCC, NAC is ultimately going to this.
Yes, entry point and exit point. So anyway, these are the systems adopted in the Western country. Now they are getting very good results. They did not spend additional money. The same money, instead of giving to the school, now they are giving to the school. You go to any school you like, go to any college you like. But then I think the same system should be adopted here also. Everything, the efficiency should be tagged with the salary. I'm sorry, salary should be tagged with the efficiency. If you are more efficient teacher, you get more salary. But everything is same now, these days. University professor and a selection grade lecturer are getting the same scale. Do you know it this time? University professor and a college lecturer in a Dikobuk college, very interior college. What is lecture here somewhere in what is called Tamulpur? Tamulpur College selection gate lecturer getting basic pay 37,400. And a professor of Guwahati University, not lecturer either, professor of Guwahati University also getting 37,400, same scale. So this is not justified, because the service the Tamulpur College or Bikomu College is giving, even not 1/4 of the service given by the university. Anyway, let me close it here.